care pie te pikitanga nare ra tena koto. Let's pray together. He honore he kororia kite atua he mangaron kite fenoa. He fakaro pai kinga tangata katoa. Hanga e te atua he nakahu. Ki roto kitena kitena omato. Lord, develop a new heart inside all of us. Whakatongia tō wairua tapu, fill us with your Holy Spirit. He awhina he tohu tohu I a mātou. He ako hoki I ngā mahi mō tēnei rā. Help us, guide us in all the things we need to learn today. Amen. Our family just moved to New Zealand about 4.5 years ago. And having been in cross-cultural work for a number of years, shifting to different cultures wasn't too unfamiliar with us, for us. And we'd been told that Kiwi culture was quite similar in a lot of ways to our own Canadian culture. So in some ways, we weren't too afraid about the adjustment. But when we got here, we realized that we definitely had a few things to learn. Being native English speakers, we were surprised just how much English we still had to learn. And we had a few cultural adjustments to make too. One of my first surprises came when I went to the grocery store and the person at the counter was concerned how I was doing. It's a bit personal, I thought, how are you? But actually, she didn't ask, how are you doing? She said, how are you going? And I said, how am I going where? Well, I didn't really, but I felt like it. Because how I'm going depends on how far it is, right? I'll have to take a plane. If it's really far, I'll walk if it's close. Well, another phrase that we soon came across was, she'll be right. And the one that goes right along with it, I think, is never mind. And as I began to learn more about Kiwi culture, I could see that there was an underlying optimistic attitude. Maybe a way of saying, we're strong people, and we can fix things ourselves. Hence all the DIY in this culture. And never mind probably meant that I don't need to bother you with my problems. Well, on the one hand, I really admire that optimism and that independence, but actually, I'm a pastoral caregiver, and I want to mind. It's part of my job. And so, And my own journey in life has taught me that there are actually some things in this life that won't be right, at least not on this side of eternity. And coming to terms with that and how it impacts our understanding of God is a really important thing. Maybe that's why I like the Book of Habakkuk. Probably many of us wouldn't go to the minor prophets as they wouldn't be go-to books when we're struggling. But Habakkuk actually is one that I find that I do go to, especially the last chapter. Because that's where we find words that we can relate to when life just doesn't seem to make sense. And when that she'll be right attitude is waning. I find someone who is honest enough to express his fears and his doubts, but is willing to accept God's sovereign plan in the end. Unlike the rest of the minor prophets, when we come to Habakkuk, we find a prophet who's not speaking to his own nation, nor to the nations around him. He's actually having a conversation with God. He's a contemporary of Jeremiah, and like Jeremiah, he's lamenting over the fact that his people of Judah had broken their covenant with God. They'd become corrupt, violent idol worshippers, ignoring the promises they had made to serve Yahweh and Yahweh alone. You can almost sense that Habakkuk feels physically surrounded by misery and evil. So he asks God that age-old question of lament. How long? How long, O Lord, must I call for help? You see this problem, and you alone have the power to fix it. So why aren't you doing anything about it? Have you ever prayed a prayer like that? I know that I have. Well, God is not silent to Habakkuk's plea, but his answer is not one that Habakkuk expected. God says that help is on the way, but his idea of solving the problem of a rebellious nation is not what Habakkuk would have hoped for. God tells him that he is raising up the Babylonians to attack the rebellious nation of Judah, just as the northern kingdom of Israel had been attacked over 100 years before that by Assyria. When we read the prophetic books of the Old Testament, we see that one of the most important themes they share is the idea that all of the events in history are in the hands of God, including all kingdoms, whether great or small. John E. Walton, an Old Testament scholar, explains that their theology was that Yahweh is never overmatched. So enemies succeeding did not mean that God had lost the plot. It just meant that God was using those enemies as part of his well-orchestrated plan. Keeping faithful to his covenant, which included blessings and curses. This was the theology of the Old Testament prophets. What's yours? How do you explain God to your non-Christian friends when prayers aren't answered in the way you had hoped? When there's so much pain and suffering in this world, where justice seems to rule? These aren't simple questions. Maybe we should all go to that conference. But there aren't simple answers either. There are many things in this life that simply don't have good explanations. And we rejoice when God gives us miracles, and so we should. But we question him when those miracles don't happen. Can we trust God that perhaps the miracle we don't receive is actually what he knows is best for us? More and more, as I continue on in this journey with Jesus, I sense that one of the most important questions that God is asking of his children is, will you trust me? This seems to be the question that he was asking of Habakkuk. And as we read this short three-chaptered book, we can see a progression, I believe, in Habakkuk's ability to trust. So let's just take a look at his journey of learning to trust and see what we can glean for ourselves as well. So the first thing we find in the book of Habakkuk is a prophet who is pouring out his heart to God in lament. This is actually a very common theme throughout the Bible, especially in the Psalms. But sadly, I feel, often unrecognized and untaught to Christians in our day. The questions of how long and why are not only in Habakkuk's head, they come pouring out in his complaints to a God that he cannot always understand. Here we see that the freedom to trust is what I was going to say. Does the PowerPoint work? You can move it from back there. All right, the freedom to trust, I was going to say, was the one of the first steps in Habakkuk's journey of learning to trust. And it's a good place for us to begin as well. I wonder if one of the reasons that we're often uncomfortable with lament is because we're afraid that it shows a lack of faith. We want to keep this "she'll be right" attitude to keep ourselves from crumbling. But I agree with author Michael Geenan, who says, lament is not a failure of faith, but an act of faith. We cry out directly to God because deep down, we know that our relationship with God counts. It counts to us and it counts to God. If we had lost our faith in him, we wouldn't cry out to him in the first place. We can be comfortable with simple, rationalistic Sunday school answers when life is going well. But when the going gets rough, we're forced to look again at what we believe. And lament corrects a naive and overly rationalistic view of faith. That's because lament forces us to go deeper, forces us to be honest with God about our doubts and questions. But it's not just complaining. Lament comes full circle to surrender and trust. You know, lament psalms make up a third of our Psalter, more than any other genre. And if you're familiar with them, you'll know that the vast majority of them start with complaint, but end with praise. Somehow, in the process of lament, the lamenting soul journeys towards trust. So if the first step in Habakkuk's progression of learning to trust God was freedom to lament, I would suggest that lament led him, there we go, we're on slide number four. I would suggest that lament led him to the second step, which was a growing knowledge of God's character. Being secure in his knowledge and understanding of God's character allowed Habakkuk to have unyielding determination to trust him. Early on in the book, Habakkuk refers to God as my rock, our rock. And it was only because he had come to know this rock and place his feet firmly on it that he was able to call up to God as he did. I can't believe in a God who would, you finish the sentence. Have you ever heard those words? Learning to trust God involves knowing how to respond to statements like this, whether they come from outside or whether they're in our own hearts. I'd recommend simply completing that sentence with whatever it is that could keep you from believing in such a God, and go to Scripture and find out if he actually is a God like that. You see, we so often shape God into our image based on our circumstances, often believing lies about who he really is. Is your story about God accurate? And is it strong enough to sustain you when tragedy strikes? I like how one author puts it. She says, the question is not about God's adequacy, but rather about the adequacy about our story about God. I can't believe in a God who would, may be an indicator that our story about God is just too small. And I'm here today to challenge us to make it our life goal to know God, to keep knowing him better and better. But part of that knowledge will be accepting the fact that he is so much greater than we could ever fully comprehend. In the end, we will need to admit, as author A.W. Tozer suggests, that there is one who lies beyond us, who exists outside of all our categories, who will not be dismissed with a name, who will not appear before the bar of our reason, nor submit to our curious inquiries. This requires a great deal of humility, more than most of us possess. So we save face by thinking God down to our level, or at least to where we can manage him. This reminds me of the conversation that Susan has with Mr. Beaver in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. Beaver explains to Susan, Aslan is a lion, the great lion. Oh, said Susan, I thought he was a man. Is he quite safe? I shall feel rather nervous about meeting a lion. Safe, said Mr. Beaver. Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe, but he's good. He's the king, I tell you. Habakkuk seems to come to this humble admission that though he could not always understand God's ways, he could know that God is a good king. He knew that God was a just king, a God who had made a covenant with Israel that included both blessings for obedience and curses for disobedience. You might remember the story at the end of the book of Joshua, where Joshua challenges the Israelites to destroy their idols and turn their hearts towards the Lord. He said, choose this day whom you will serve. And they cry out, yes, of course we will serve the Lord our God. We would never abandon the Lord and serve other gods. We will obey him alone. sadly, we turn the page to Judges, and what do we find? The book of Judges concludes by saying all the people did whatever was right in their own eyes. As is human nature, God's chosen people were happy to take the promises of blessing from God, but when he kept his promises, which included the consequences for their disobedience, suddenly his justice didn't seem so just. Habakkuk's theology included an understanding of a covenant-keeping God. His understanding was that the Babylonian army was part of God's justice, as Sally explained to us a few weeks ago. This, however, did not mean that God's plans for Judah were over. Habakkuk understood that though a godless, violent nature might be a tool in the hand of God, Babylon's pride and arrogance would not reign forever. Though he was initially shocked that God would use the Babylonians, that did not lead him to despair. In chapter 2, verse 1, we read, "I will climb up to my watchtower and stand at my guard post. There I will wait to see what the Lord says and how he will answer my complaint." One commentator suggests, when it comes to the ways of God, sooner or later, we will all need to reach a position where we genuinely decide to watch and wait rather than wrestle with our rational processes. Habakkuk's growing knowledge and understanding of God filled him with awe, and he proclaims, "As the waters fill the sea, the earth will be filled with the awareness of the glory of the Lord." This is the Almighty, all-powerful God that he knows and learns to trust. Is your story about God adequate enough to stand secure when the storms of life batter your faith? Like many of you, I've had a desire to know God throughout my Christian life, but I remember feeling that longing, perhaps in a deeper way, about 3.5 years ago. Paul was leading a New Year's Eve cafe service here at Northgate with the theme being your new normal. Remember that, Paul? We were given a sheet of questions to complete and share with those around us. Several months later, when I happened to find that sheet and saw what I'd written, I was quite taken aback at how God had taken my desires seriously. Too seriously, perhaps. To the question, what might God be calling you to in 2018, I had written, being used in the way he's designed me to be used, being more secure in my identity in Christ, continual growth in parenting. The next question was this: what, therefore, could your new normal look like this year? And I had written, accepting unknowns, not having the "it shouldn't be this way" attitude. Little did I know that the greatest unknown for me would take place just 13 days later when I became a widow and single mom. Never in a million years would I have dreamed that one of the greatest battles in the months to come would be fighting that "it should be this way" attitude. Did I really want to know God in a deeper way? My circumstances gave me the opportunity to expand my story about God. I came to know a love like no other. This was part of my journey of learning to trust in a whole new way. We can see that for Habakkuk, learning to trust included, first of all, the freedom to lament, secondly, an ever-deepening knowledge and understanding of God's character. And as we come to chapter 3, we see a third step in his journey in learning to trust. And that is that he begins walking by faith and not by sight. God's revelation to him fills him with awe, and he begins to have renewed hope. He says, "I see God moving across the deserts from Edom, the Holy One coming from Mount Paran. His brilliant splendor fills the heavens, and the earth is filled with praise." And we all know that you cannot see an invisible God. But through the eyes of faith, Habakkuk could see God moving. And like him, as we learn to know God more, our eyes will be opened in new ways to see him at work. It was walking by faith and not by sight that led Habakkuk to come full circle in his lament. In perhaps one of the most well-known passages in the Minor Prophets, we read his even though prayers. He holds on to the hope that God will not let evil go unpunished, and he surrenders to the sovereign Lord, even though his situation had not yet changed. He proclaims that even though the fig trees have no blossoms and there are no grapes on the vine, even though the olive crop fails and the fields lie empty and barren, even though the flocks die in the fields and the cattle barns are empty, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in the God of my salvation. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes me sure-footed as a deer, able to tread the heights. I don't know about you, but so often when I come to a mountain that seems insurpassable in life, I sense God asking me, will you trust me? Will you trust me? Will you trust me? When we face those mountains, we need to stop and ask ourselves, what is keeping me from being able to trust God in this situation? I suspect that one of the biggest obstacles to trusting is fear. Fear that God really isn't big enough or powerful enough or able enough to see us through. And it's true that trusting him is scary at times, even as scary as treading the heights like the deer that Habakkuk speaks of. I'm definitely not one for heights, but in the physical realm, but I often fear the metaphorical mountains in life as well. And I sometimes wonder how God can actually keep his promise of making me as sure-footed on them and being that being a reality. But as we look back on our lives and see God's hand of faithfulness, as we find freedom to lament, as we grow in our knowledge of an unchanging God, his character, and begin to walk by faith and not by sight, then step by step, maybe baby step by baby step at times, we will grow in our ability to trust God alone. Why? Because we will have seen that how very, very trustworthy he is. Lately, my son Micah and I have gotten into watching action movies. And we were watching Mission Impossible recently, the one where Ethan Hunt is engaged to be married. So now, of course, his bride-to-be doesn't know anything about the fact that he has a secret identity as a CIA agent. Small fact to leave out when you're proposing to someone. That's a CIA agent. But as the story goes, he's called off to another job, and he's acting a bit strange. So his fiancée presses him to find out what's going on here. He's reluctant. He can't tell her. So he simply says, I need to ask you something. I need you to trust me. She replies, of course I trust you. But then she asks, am I ever going to be able to understand what this is? And his reply is, I need you to trust me. She says, yes, I'll trust, but tell me it's real. Well, the next scene takes us to a little chapel in the hospital where she works, and Ethan Hunt, the great secret agent, proves his trustworthiness and undying love by making her his wife. Now, if we humans can prove ourselves trustworthy, how much more trustworthy is God? Christ took a similar vow, making us his bride, and he, the most faithful bridegroom in history, has every right to ask us if we will trust him. As we celebrated in communion, God made a new covenant with us. The curse for our disobedience fell on him. Christ, who said his own even though prayers at the end of his life on this earth, gave his life. And the giving of his life was the only thing that it made it possible possible for us to have a right relationship with God and have the promise of a day when she will be right, a day when he will wipe away every tear from our eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. For the old order of things has passed. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. Yes, we long for that day. But each day, until we get there, we have the privilege of allowing him to take us deeper in our knowledge of God, to our knowledge of him and his great love for us. And as we learn to desire him most of all, as Jonathan talked about last week, we begin to see how very trustworthy he is. We begin to live more abundant lives, and soon we may find, like the sure-footed deer, that we too can tread the heights. Let's pray. Father, thank you for who you are, our great and awesome and mighty God. Lord, when we can't understand, when we don't know what's ahead, when we have fears that distract us from you, I pray, Father, that we will learn to know how very trustworthy you are, and that we will place our hope and our trust firmly in you. Take us deeper on this journey of learning to trust, I pray. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.